Alrighty, Kites, you are live.
Hello.
Hello. Hi.
Okay, I just wanted to pick you guys' brains about how only...
First off, I'm a geologist, and you never say I want to pick your brains to a geologist, because we think of like a big stone pick. Sorry. I was just making a joke. Sorry I cut you off.
I just wanted to get you guys' opinion on how only about 1 to 5% of the population back in the time where the Bible was written, it's so fascinating that only like that many people or that percentage of people could, you know, that were literate and they came up with, you know, the Bible that we have today.
And
I just wanted to see like how you guys...
It was the stories of the Bible had nothing to do with people being literate. The stories were handed down mouth to mouth until literacy became a thing, correct? Now, you could say the same thing about any other place in the world, that we had very complex stories that were handed down mouth to mouth to mouth until there was a point of literacy when those stories could be written down, like at the point when they invented cuneiform to write down the stories of the Sumerian gods. So I don't think that when we look at the Middle East, it was anything unique or different than anywhere else in the world.
Well, and I'm going to take this maybe a different direction, and feel free to turn it back if this isn't the direction you meant to go in. I think lack of literacy is actually why the Bible has thrived for so long. I think lack of education and the inability to be literate is part of what makes religion so powerful, because the people who can read, and which are statistically usually people in power, people of wealth, people of status, can tell everyone else what it says, whether or not that's actually what it says. And if you look, especially in the United States, especially, there is, and this is just statistics, so come for me in the comments if they want, but this just statistically, the higher the rate of religious individuals usually correlates very directly with the lower the education quality, scores, availability, access, literacy. So when I think, oh, such a low population of the people were literate at the time the Bible was written, my brain goes, that tracks.
And to Sydney's point also, the list of books that the Catholic Church banned, that list didn't come into existence until literacy was widespread.
Right.
That's interesting to think about.
Yeah. But, what are your thoughts on the matter?
Okay. I've recently just been getting into the Bible again, and mm-hmm. I just find just... like the fact that they just, these stories, these allegories, they still stretch like far into time. And it's like time just keeps on repeating itself. And, you know, you can really just go in the Bible and find things that stick out even today and whatnot. And
are you a theist?
I just find it so amazing that these people were able. I mean, me right now, I wouldn't necessarily call myself an atheist or like a traditional theist, not even an agnostic in a way.
Just curious, like, I believe more like
that there is a God. I just feel that he is, or she, it is just more complex than what I can really conjure up, that I can really just imagine and whatnot. And I can't really trust the Bible. I can't really trust the Quran, because, you know, these books are written by just like dozens of people over just hundreds of years, and like all the contradictions and whatnot in them. But yeah. I feel the will just to believe in something out there that I don't understand.
Yeah, and I think to your point, I think there's a very clear distinction between the parts of the Bible that come from, like Kelley was talking about, where it was like, it was stories and lessons, very Aesop's fable style. And I think there's a big distinction between that part of the Bible and the parts of the Bible that the people I was talking about, the literate leadership, decided to invent rules and put towards their advantage. I think there's a huge difference between those two parts of the Bible, and I think it's very visible. For example, I've always thought that the stories from the Bible that are the most famous were meant to be Aesop's fables, like Adam and Eve, like Jonah being swallowed by the whale. I think that was a fictional story that was meant to teach a lesson, very similar to the tortoise and the hare. And then the people who wrote the rest of the Bible, the dark, sad, depressing, rule-oriented, like slave positive parts of the Bible, took what was supposed to be just lessons, just, you know, fictitious stories meant to teach a lesson, and said, no, this is real. This is actual rules. These are the ways you need to believe this happened. And also, don't eat pork, and also stone your daughter to death if she's not a virgin, and also, and they took that and they ran with it, and they made it something more than it was ever supposed to be. So the stories that were told verbally that were basically just supposed to teach us a lesson then became the written Bible that we know today, which is also full of punishment, sacrifice, rules, fear mongering, stuff like that.
Yeah, I never looked at it in that lens. But I definitely don't think the Bible is meant to be seen as just completely just literal.
Right.
And I like how Presbyterians, I like their view on it and whatnot, as compared to Baptists and whatnot, where just everything is literate and you can't even have the slightest imagination that it's not that what it is. It's all up for interpretation.
Isn't it also interesting that the exact same people who say the Bible is not up for interpretation, it means what it says and it says what it means, when you bring up the bad parts, they go, no, it was a different time. It was the translation. What it actually meant was this. Isn't that interesting? I think that's fascinating.
Yeah, definitely. I also wanted to ask you guys about what do you think about religious wars, what's going on in Palestine or Israel, whichever side you want to.
Yeah.
I think it's wrong.
Whatnot.
I think it's one of the main problems we have with religions, when people are fighting over what God they believe in. That's a problem.
Absolutely. And I think there are a lot of wars that start from so many different places that if you even try to identify the origin, it's just a muddled mess. But especially the religious aspects, I think it's really sad, because people who are so religious that they're willing to fight wars for their God, I consider those people to be brainwashed individuals. I consider those people to be victims of brainwashing. And the fact that they are willing to kill mass numbers of other brainwashed, victimized individuals, to me, is just really, really sad. Just really, really sad. And I think it's very unfortunate that so many millions of people over history have died over things that we can't even prove to be true, let alone kill each other over it.
Yeah, I definitely agree with both of you. But how would you think, do you think there is a way that you could even solve a problem like that?
A problem like what?
In the near future.
Get rid of religion. It's the only, the only way to solve the problems with religion is to get rid of religion, period.
Yeah. I think the type of people that believe in religion will always believe in something. So I think that even if, say, for example, somehow we wiped Catholicism, we wiped Baptist and American Christianity off the map, we somehow got rid of what we know to be Islam, I think humans will always gravitate and be susceptible to something like religion, whether it's multi-level marketing, whether it's a celebrity they worship, whether it's we have these speakers that host these big events, and people show up to these events and they're crying, and it's like supposed to be some kind of business get together, but it ends up being almost like a worship ceremony. Unfortunately, I don't think we'll ever be able to eliminate the part of the human brain in some people that makes them susceptible to indoctrination. I do think we are capable of getting rid of that in power. I do think there will, I hope there will be a day where that won't exist in lawmaking and that won't exist in national leadership. But I think in humans, I don't think we'll ever be able to eliminate the need that some people have for something to tell them what to do.
Okay. Me personally, I don't think religion is necessarily a problem, but like extremist views and just overcompensating for whatever turmoil you may have going on and relying solely on religion, maybe it is a bad thing, but definitely extremism is is nothing but a cancer. And I feel like there is a need for religion in a way, at least for a decent amount of the population. I mean, a decent amount of population already is pre-religious, but I think there is a need for it. And I think it is a good thing in a way, maybe not always, maybe not 100% of the time, but at least a good, maybe 30.
Here, you know what? This is something I always ask people when they say they think religion is a good thing, that we need it. What positive thing does religion give to us that isn't either just a promise of something in the future or something that we couldn't get from a secular means? Is there anything in religion that we that isn't one of those two things that's a positive?
You know, that's a good question. For me, religion, even though I probably could get it from like a secular view, but as far as this, even like the elders in my family, like it feels like community between like everyone, and like even me, like as a kid.
Yeah, but you can get that from a secular source. People do all the time. People have bowling leagues. There you go. You got community.
Maybe so, but it's a little bit different than bowling in a way. At least
right. Like, yeah. People help because I'm going to help all the people out of my league if they're having problems. I'm going to help all the people that belong to my neighborhood watch. I'm going to help all the people that of any group of people that I hang out with and I have learned to become friends with. If one of those people has something negative happen to them, because they are my friends, I am going to be there to help them. I don't need Jesus. I don't need Allah. I don't need Brahma to do that. I can just help my friend.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you on that too, but what about when things happen things that happen in your life where you just can't explain them, and they may not be necessarily like.
Well, here, you know what? You said something earlier, Kais, and I didn't say anything at the time, but you said you have to have something outside yourself to believe in. Why? Why instead don't you take that belief and put it inside yourself? Why does it have to be outside of you?
I mean, me personally, I believe in myself. But I just can't help but think.
No, but you still believe you have to find something outside yourself. Why? What is the purpose of finding something outside?
If I may interject, I think there is, this is a book that I recommend all the time. There's a book called Why We Believe in Gods by J. Anderson Thompson. Highly recommend everybody read it. It's a very quick read, so informative. It'll change your life. But I do think evolutionarily, there are people that need guidance and leadership. And a lot of times we talk about the two types of people when we talk about cults. We talk about the people who lead cults and the people who follow cults. And these two types of people will always exist. And I think the same exact personality traits, the same exact evolutionary traits that make somebody depend on God or depend on religion or depend on serving a deity will always make them want to be involved in something. So say, for example, we eliminate religion. I think something else will take the place of religion, whether it's somebody gets elected into office who everybody loves so much that they just start to basically worship this person, or somebody becomes just a massive musician and people are such big fans that they start to change how they live and how they dress and how they act based on this musician, or an organization like CrossFit, they get so involved in fitness that that becomes their religion and they start to glorify, say, influencers in that space. I think the same exact people who follow religion will always find something, even if it's not God, even if it's not the Bible, to show them who they need to be and how they need to be and to follow. There's just like that personality trait that makes them follow. And the people who we find leading these groups will always evolutionarily be more prone to lead groups. And so as long as human beings exist, even if we eliminate religion, I think there will be something that we quote unquote worship, or that we quote unquote, you know, pray to, in the same way that we now get that need fulfilled through religion, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I agree. Like people, they need to find there's something that they can, in a way, love outside of themselves. Yeah. If they just have, I know it might sound like cringy, or like they just want to like love something greater than themselves and whatnot. But back to the previous point, like I really think that, I mean, have you ever had something in your life where it's just like, you know, you might have a dream and then it pops up like in real life. And then, yeah. Like, okay, you just break
it off
like,
one law.
Time, and then it happens again, and then it happens like three times, and it's like you can't help but think that there might be, I don't know, something like even just larger at play and whatnot.
Yeah. That's just Littlewood's law to me.
Yeah, and I think people would be lying if they said they didn't wish there was something really, really cool, you know, waiting for us on the other side after life, you know, some kind of prize or heavenly type thing waiting for us. But I think most of what human beings experience that's supernatural or that seems like something that would be a gift from God can eventually be explained by science, even if we don't know now. Like ghosts, supernatural experiences that we have, inexplicable experiences. I do think there's an answer for all of those things. Science just hasn't figured it out yet. And maybe one day they'll have an answer for why those things exist. But it's still cool to experience. I still love when I have a dream and then the dream comes true. But in my mind, that's just either coincidence or there's an explanation for that that I just don't have at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah. So I had something I wanted to say. I can't think of it right now.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Well, Kites, well then I thank you so much for calling in. It's really great to talk to you. I'm going to let you go. But if you think of that other thing you wanted to say, please call in. You can call in this time. You can call in another time. We'd love to hear back from you because I thought this was an interesting conversation. Thank you so much for calling in.